And here's our page. And I will just tell you, many art historians consider this to be the greatest Persian painting ever created. This is their Sistine Chapel. This is their masterpiece. Fans of Behzad might say, not so fast, but this painting has stood out among 258 of the greatest paintings. This is Persia's High Renaissance. They got there through Behzad, but this period of Persian painting is their High Renaissance, and it's exquisite. So this is miniature painting, opaque watercolor on paper with gold, probably some silver, and this is the best page. And you can see who collected it when the manuscript was began to be taken apart and sold. One of the wealthiest and greatest collectors of Islamic art in the world at the time. You get this wonderful sense, unlike other like album pages and some other manuscripts where there might be multiple pieces of paper separate from the real page, it's all worked out, the composition on the single page. So you have some text couplets that relate to this part of the story. And then there are other pages that are just text, folios between these. The borders are uniform on all pages of this manuscript, and it's done by first flicking water, and I believe they use as a binder gum arabic. So this is natural kind of sticky stuff, and you mix it up, and it's flicked across the page, and then gold dust is just sprayed across it. And you shake it off, and you get this gorgeous flecked, shimmering surface. And then you have gold, burnished gold paint background here to create this mythical sky for this mythical scene. This is Gaia Mars. This is perhaps the first illustration in the Shahnameh. It is the first chapter of the Shahnameh, because he is the first king at the beginning of time who rules this garden paradise. And you see him sitting enthroned at the peak of a mountain in the wilderness. And all of these people and animals surrounding him in this wonderful circular, kind of surging, pulsating composition. And so the book begins. What does the Persian poet say about the first man to seek the crown of world sovereignty? No one has any knowledge of those first days unless he has heard tales passed down from father to son. This is what those tales tell. The first man to be king and establish the ceremonies associated with the crown and throne was Gaia Mars. When he became lord of the world, he lived first in the mountains, where he established his throne, and he and his people dressed in leopard skins. It was he who first taught men about the preparation of food and clothing, which were new in the world at the time. Seated on his throne, as splendid as the sun, he reigned for 30 years. He was like a tall cypress tree topped by the full moon, and the royal fur shone from him, the royal far. All animals of the world, wild and tame alike, reverently paid homage to him, bowing down before his throne, and their obedience increased his glory and good fortune. It will then go on to talk about his son. Simiac grew into a fine son. He had no enemies except for Al-Hirmir, Ahirman. I could print things bigger, perhaps. Who was secretly jealous of his splendor and looked for ways to trouble him and humble him. Ahirman had a son who was like a savage wolf, and this fearless youth gathered an army together and spread sedition throughout the world and prepared to attack the king. So that's the first chapter. And here I think we are looking at Gaia Mars, and most likely this noble figure in furs leaning into him is his son. So look at this. I mean, look at the, so we know gold is expensive. There's no shortage of it here. But what about the blue? Lapis. Lots of luxurious materials. Look at the fine detail. When people talk about Sultan Muhammad, they often talk about his boldness, his creativity, his almost wildness, kind of a visionary kind of painter. And I think you see it in these paintings. Often he has kind of a circular composition. And here, these, remember those rugged Chinese mountains and black ink painted gnarly Chinese trees? Look how beautiful they've become, how decorative almost, but how alive. And they're filled with imagery. Do you see this? Camel head. And so there's this wonderful play going on in the painting. And imagine if you had it, you were a courtier, I guess, how else would you get to see it? But you can sit and spend hours looking at these paintings, finding faces and animals hidden throughout the landscape and poking through the mountains. Big. You can buy the great study on this book is by Stuart Carey Welch and Martin. Two scholars, a historian and linguist and an art historian. And they spent over a decade studying the manuscripts at Harvard and writing the book. And they're the ones who associate the artists with their period, with what was going on, and the connoisseurship of who did what. And the book is printed in two volumes, life size. And so one volume are the reproductions of the paintings, and the other volume is the text. And this is the hardest damn thing. They're the heaviest things you could imagine. But I think the Met has just reissued it. What ends up happening in the end is it's bought by a man named Arthur Houghton of the Houghton Mifflin family, who was an art collector and associated with the Houghton Library at Harvard. And he eventually, in the 70s, decided to break it up. And there may be, you know, very good tax purposes on his part for doing it, because as this increased in fame and value, this thing, owning it, became a financial liability. I honestly think that has something to do with this. And you can ask me afterwards with a glass of wine about some of the stories about what happened here. But he first removed a group of pages and gave them to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and then he began to sell others. So the Met has the greatest group of single folios. They have 70. When you go to the Met today in those beautiful new Islamic galleries, they have a rotating section in the Persian Gallery, big kind of kind of a wall case with the glass, and things are tipped out, and there's a rail so you can lean in, and they rotate these. So every time you go to the Met, you can see some of this manuscript. The other, what was left, the bound portions that were left, still with paintings and text, were actually traded with the Iranian government after the Iranian Revolution. We did a diplomatic trade, because after the revolution, they didn't want their de Kooning woman anymore, and they wanted this, and we traded. And depending on if you are a modern contemporary person or a Persian, you wonder who got the better deal. But the whole half the manuscript and illustrations are now back in Tehran, which is somehow quite fitting. Where's this one? This one is in Toronto at the Aga Khan Museum. So here's some more wonderful details. All of the people learning how to dress themselves in leopard skins, and the wonderful animals who come. And in this Garden of Eden setting, you see predator and prey laying down together. It's a time of peace. It's a mythical story.
And these.
It does, doesn't it? So early people, and then the first, yeah, the young son, and then another person has a son, and he can't get along with him. So war happens in the world pretty quickly. Look at these wonderful monkeys duking it out, arguing. They're really animated faces. And the way they allow, and a lot of the folios do this, the imagery to just spill over the borders. And the obvious comparison that you'll want to make between the rugged Central Asian cosmopolitan early Persian painting and the highly refined, like a high Renaissance or a Gothic manuscript. Beautiful, elegant king in the Shahnameh of Shah Tahmasp. And here's another folio by Sultan Muhammad, and you can see in this one there is something similar, a court scene, circular composition, kind of exploding off either side. This one's in the Met. You can see Gift of Art, Arthur Houghton. Very fine painting, Asiatic, but different. No longer, they look Chinese. It's Chinese inspired, but it's become something different. Flat landscape, little vegetation, wonderful details like the luxurious metalwork, their drinking vessels, their food. I think the Persians don't really do it until the Qajar dynasty, so I think they're choosing not to. They don't do it to a pretty modern dynasty. Then you start to see it in the paintings. I think they're keeping that flat, tipped up background. It's part of their tradition, part of their visual language. And it makes it easy to tell a story, doesn't it? You can have the big figure can be in the back, right? At the top of the hill, and he can be bigger than the others. You know, there's a clarity with this. These are kind of imaginary worlds that are created in these paintings. So here we are, this wonderful detail, again, a Sultan Muhammad. And look at this like bear thing up here, gonna drop a rock on this leopard who's eyeing these birds. I mean, you could spend hours with one of these. Oh, here's some. Yeah, you can really see it here. These are a dream. So it's your job to get your kids as excited about looking at a miniature painting as they are about looking at Liberty Leading the People or some big old, you know. Yeah, where's Waldo? Give them a list, you know, things to look for and find it. Because that's the whole point. It's the hardest thing to do in a museum, too, because, you know, we're used to surveys that show people spend, on average, 2 seconds in front of a work of art, if you're lucky, before they move on. So, you know, something like a big Robert Motherwell does well, but how do you get them to stop and look at that? Because in 2 seconds, you've missed it, and that could have really been a transformative experience for you to find those things. Well, so this is a question actually that you could relate to the breaking up of the manuscript. Because if they were all still in the book and that book was in Tehran, nobody would ever get to experience it. So one argument, I'm not advocating as a curator, let's go cut everything up and spread it around. But since it's happened, thousands and thousands of people have gotten to experience this. So I'm not advocating for that. I think people in the field feel this is a horrible shame that it happened in our modern time when we should have known better. But I can tell you that if it's in the book, you would probably never ever get to see Guyamar's. How often would it ever be open to that front page as opposed to any other page? How often would that be shown to the public? And, but you're right, this was a court experience. This wouldn't have been held up for a public reading. So as big as it is, it still was for elite production. It was a symbolic political object, and it was one of the most beautiful books ever made.